Good morning, everyone. Thanks to be connected. So we will be waiting a few minutes for everyone to connect in order to be able to start at 11 on time. So quick introduction from my side. I am Capucine Fargier, manager at IAC Partners and in charge of the automotive sector with particular focus on electrification topics recently. So I will be presenting this webinar dedicated to mobility electrification. If you have any questions, then you will be able to raise them in the chat. In the chat, and then we will send you the replay of the webinar, the presentation early next week. So I will be able to answer any questions you would have either during the presentation or at the end. So yes, you can raise them in the chat, and depending on the timing, then we'll see if we answer to these questions either during the presentation or if we gather them at the end. Okay, I see it's time, so let's start. Good morning, everyone. Thank you to be connected to this mobility electrification webinar. So let's start. So a quick presentation for all of you. I am Capucine Fargier, manager at IAC Partners, in charge of the electrification topic, which will be the main point of discussion for today. So again, we have a chat on the top right hand corner of the screen, so you can raise any questions or comments you would have, and we'll try as much as possible to answer you either during the presentation or at the end. If you would have any additional questions after the webinar, you will be able as well to contact us by email, and then we will send you next Monday the replay of the presentation and the slides which will be presented. So about the agenda of the presentation, so we will start with a quick introductions before having a look at the sales forecast for electric vehicles and the associated key challenges. Then a summary of what are the key trends for the powertrain and which are the associated impacts on the value chain. A fourth section will be dedicated to the charging station landscape, and we will finish with a slide dedicated to what are the six success factors to reach a competitive positioning in the EV markets. And then quick Q&A. So let's start. Digitalization and connectivity are actually redefining the ways we move from place to place, and there are thus four key automotive megatrends which are now shaping the future of vehicles. So the first one, and the one which will be the focus for our webinar today, is related to electrification of vehicles. So actually, the quite recent and strong growth which we have been observing this past months and years is currently pushed by a number of events, which includes, for instance, evolving consumers' attitudes, in particular following the COVID-19 crisis. Some technological improvements are impacting this growth. So this is, for instance, the targets of decreasing OEMs battery costs, which have set up targets by 2022 to reach unit costs which would be below $100 per kilowatt. On top of this, we have also all major OEMs which are setting ambitious target shares regarding the sales of EVs, electric vehicles, by 2025. On average, these are ranging between 20 to 25% of their total sales. And this is as well supported and backed by strong and ambitious government plans. So the two additional megatrends related to shared autonomy, shared transportation and connected transportation won't be the focus of today's discussion. And to finish, we have autonomy. So autonomous driving, which is coming to reality as major OEMs have announced major progress, such as levels 3 and 4. And so the evolution of the regulation and the way local governments will support or not these trends will actually be the most important challenges to be tackled for automated vehicles developments. So focusing on electrifications, let's now have a look at what are the EV sales growth and forecasts. So actually, global sales of electric cars accelerated quite fast in 2020. And this despite overall car sales dropping by around one-fifth last year due to the coronavirus pandemic. For 2021, there are about 150 new BEV and PHEVs models which are expected to enter the market. So this is actually indicating that 2021 will see a continued growth as well. And so as an illustration and to complete, for instance, General Motors a few days ago indicated that it plans to sell EVs only by 2035. So in the next 15 years, 100% of expected sales from General Motors will be EVs. And actually, this is quite in line with the recent and various number of diesel bans, which are being set up by an increasing number of governments. In 2020, actually, Tesla was the brand selling the most electric cars by delivering almost 500,000 new cars, and it was followed by Volkswagen. Tesla's approach of selling cars directly to customers rather than going by franchised dealers have probably been one of the success factors to sell this number of new cars. And this is why this trend has been followed as well by other car makers, such as Volkswagen, which took this sales approach as well in 2020. In terms of regional share, so for last year, the five largest national markets have been first and by far China, which was then followed by Germany, the US, France, and the UK. So this was the top five regional markets. So for this strong growth to become a reality by 2030, actually three main challenges needs to be outperformed. So the first one is related to increasing the range of EVs in order to face one of the major psychological barrier which customers were facing until now, and which is what we call the range anxiety. So actually the fear of running out of power during the journey. So this was one of the first challenges to be tackled, but now due to technological improvements, we are able to surpass this one. So now the two major ones which have to be faced are next, so the need to improve the charging speed. So this is why OEMs are putting efforts, strong efforts, and investing in the development of ultra-fast charging stations. And this is to actually answer to the demand to reduce EV charging time, which are required to reach similar levels of the time you need to fill your petrol tank, meaning in a 15 minutes time slot. And the third one, actually, which is maybe the most important one, if we want electric vehicles to reach the mass markets, is associated to the reduction of the TCO, the total cost of ownership. Actually, for EVs to reach the mass market, it is critical that TCO reach similar level to the one of traditional vehicles. So to do so, we have two main drivers which will contribute to this. So the first one is related to technological improvements, with, for instance, some expected improvements at battery level, where we expect on average that battery energy density will be rising at a range between 4 to 5% per year, and this will be mainly due to new chemistries which will be hitting the markets. And then the next driver which will enable to reach lower TCO will be related to higher level of standardization and modularity, and this at components levels, which will enable actually to adapt to a variety of configurations which will be entering on the market on the short term. So actually, these three challenges are impacting the entire powertrain layouts, and this at the unit components level. So this is what we will see in the next slide. So looking back not even a decade ago, actually, the automotive industry was made of the same two powertrain types, which have been characterizing the industry for close to a century now. So this was the gasoline and the diesel powertrain. Now, and this is what you can see in this slide, which seems to be quite complex actually, is that we have the powertrain, and in particular the e-powertrain, which is becoming more and more complex. And this is due to the fact that we have a broad mix of technical solutions, but as well of EV types of vehicles, as the industry is heading towards full electric vehicles. So as the powertrain portfolio is diversifying, actually, the powertrain components landscape is thus becoming more complex, but as well more dynamic. And these changes are affecting all major OEMs, but as well all suppliers and new entrants on the entire powertrain chain. And on top of this, this is taking place at a pace which no one would have foreseen a few years ago. So out of this broad mix of solutions, actually some key trends are still emerging, and this is what we will see next now. So we see that there are four technological key trends which are emerging and which are impacting actually most or almost all technical blocks of the powertrain. So we have one trend related to increasingly have modular designs at component and system level. Second trend is related to the merge of components into systems as well. The third one is related to the development and the integration of new technologies in order to be able to reach new performance levels at accessible cost. And the fourth one is increasing integration of software reconfigurable vehicles, so what we call SaaS. To illustrate and have more details on the first one, so modular design, it is key for suppliers to provide solutions which are actually suited to a very high diversity of platforms, as we saw on the previous slides. So in order to be able to suit this diversity of platform and also be able to leverage on the strong R&D investments which are required to develop these new systems, modular design is key for suppliers to optimize their ROI, their return on investments on systems, and address a wider number of platforms. Regarding the second trend, so the merge of components, this is, for instance, the integration of the inverter and the motor into the same subsystem. And this is actually impacting the ecosystem, the value chain, as this is blurring the lines between the suppliers in the value chain with, for instance, tier one suppliers, which are integrating value from tier two suppliers. And to finish on this, so focus on the fourth trend, so regarding software reconfigurable vehicles. So actually, software over the air technology offers manufacturers, OEMs, and OEMs in particular, the opportunity to reduce costs. And thus, by, for instance, cutting the cost of managing warranty problems. And on top of this, this is as well a way and a lever for OEMs to increase revenues through, for instance, the development of after-sales initiatives. So actually, these trends, as we saw, are impacting the entire e-powertrain chain, but as well are impacting the entire automotive value chain with a number of key changes on the value chains, which we will focus on now. So as we see this, as we saw, these major changes are actually requiring the entry on the market and in particular on the ecosystem of a new number of players. So first type of new players which are entering the ecosystems are non-automotive players actually, which for instance, made more than 90% of the total investments in mobility startups this last months or years. Then we have a second type of of new players which are entering the ecosystems. So these are the technological.
Sorry, we may have a small technical problem. So Capucine, maybe can you exit the full screen mode? One sec.
Just full screen mode.
And then go back to full screen and maybe this will be better. Just a quick restart. No, a little desynchronization. I'm sorry for that. Okay, can you go back a little bit? Okay, so this one is okay. And the next one? Okay. And the next one. Okay, so you were on this one, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, it's better. Okay.
Okay, sorry for this. It's good now?
Yeah.
Good. So yeah, as I was saying, so we have a number of new players entering on the ecosystem. So first type of new players are non-automotive players. Second type of new players actually are technological giants, which are the other type of players which are shaking up this automotive industry by increasing competition in a big way. And this is mainly related to the fact that we are backed by a large, that they are backed by large cash reserves actually, and they are as well trying to redefine the way mobility will look in the future. So quite a disruptive entrance. So in this new ecosystem, actually, cooperation within the automotive industry is not new, but will become an even bigger success factors for the coming years. So in light of this, OEMs should not neglect their traditional strengths, meaning that they should continue focusing on their core skills, which are focusing on design, keep sustaining production excellence, and as well maintain a big and strong service operations footprint. And on top of this, so they can learn from tech companies on three dimensions, which will be first to create new ecosystems and new business models. Second, to forge some additional partnerships with new players. And the third one will be to establish new levers for efficiency. So, if you remind well, so the second challenge with, which was mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, so was related to the charging stations capabilities. So let's now deep dive into this topic. So here we have a view of the number of charging stations which were installed and deployed worldwide as of 2019. So actually there was more than 7 million charging stations worldwide. Out of this 7 million, close to 90% were private chargers. So these are actually chargers which each consumer can install in his garage for instance. Then on top of this, so we have public chargers, so which are installed either on the road or in city centers, and they are split into two types. So still, the majority as of today is related to what are called slow chargers, so meaning these are chargers with charging power which is of less than 22 kilowatts. But increasingly, we expect fast chargers to enter the market in order to reduce charging time quite drastically. So in 2019, just to put figures, in 2019, there was more than 260,000 fast chargers installed worldwide. In terms of a regional share, so in 2019, China was a country which had installed and which were dominating the markets, as it was the one which represented around 60% of the number of public stations, and it was as well in China that 80% of the public fast chargers were installed in 2019. So let's now have a look at how this is expected to grow in the coming years. So actually, forecasts for expected growth by 2030 can be split into two scenarios. So we have a first scenario, which is a conservative scenario, and which actually is associated to what would be the growth if we follow what are current stated policies forecasting. And the second scenario, which would be a more optimistic scenario, and which would actually be related to a more sustainable growth for the next 10 years. So even so, private chargers are still expected to dominate the market by 2030. The number of fast chargers is expected to represent, in the optimistic scenario by 2030, a total market potential of around 2.6 million chargers by 2030. On top of this, so public chargers are expected as well to potentially be a substitute to private chargers in the case where we would have enough number of public stations installed. So even though slow chargers are around 90% of the total public installations, we expect strong growth and innovations to be tackled actually for the fast charging market. So as we can see, so there is strong growth expected for the coming years, and this will be attracting and is currently attracting actually quite a number of new players on the ecosystems as well. So this is what we can see here. So don't be afraid if this slide might look a little bit messy, but actually this is reflecting the diversity of the ecosystems. And this is as well reflecting the fact that as of today, as this is a quite new market and in development, the charging station ecosystem is currently very fragmented. And on top of that, so in order to be successful on this segment, so we see that there is a very high number of partnerships and joint ventures which are being created among players. And this is actually to enable two main points. So the first one will be to be able to grow the charger network actually, and benefit from by benefiting mainly from volume effects. And the second key benefits of partnerships and joint ventures, so will be to be enable to push for product innovations. And in particular, product innovations which will be required on the fast charging stations. On top of this, so we can see that we have a new type of players which are entering into the ecosystem. So these are mainly large oil leaders, so such as BP, Total, and Shell, which are actually feeling the heat on the EV market and associated growth, and which are trying to rely on their existing network to develop new EV charging stations network. What we can see as well is that OEMs and all major OEMs are as well entering into the ecosystem, and this in order to make EVs more lucrative and thus by contributing actually to the development of chargers networks in specific region or countries, focusing on particular on the development of supercharger networks. So to illustrate, this is for instance the case of Tesla in the US, which is developing its own network, which is compliant only with test trackers. And we have a similar example as well in China with XPeng Motors, which is as well financing part of the developments and installations of charging stations across the countries in order to be able to sell more of his cars. So as we are coming close to the end, let's switch to the success factors to reach competitive positioning in the EV ecosystem. And actually here in this slide, we try to sum up what are the six key success capabilities to be developed if key players want to reach a competitive positioning in this ecosystem. So the first one actually is related to technological advance. So with the massification of electric vehicles, which is expected by 2030, actually it is mandatory and it requires a high level of efficiency at component level. And this at a low cost, and while still being more and more compact. So this will enable actually the adoption of this will be enabled actually by the adoption of new technologies such as SiC, for instance, in power electronics or liquid cooling. Then next success factor is related to the mass market readiness. So strong investments which are required for research and development to develop these new products actually will require some strong financial capacities to be able, on top of this, to product on at a large scale to reach the mass market. Third success factor, so is related to the time to market. It is critical and major for OEMs and suppliers to be agile with a clear product roadmap in order to be able to launch new products, new components at the right time and with associated quantities and volumes. And so to finish, I will mainly focus on the last factors, which is related to actually access to the ecosystem and partnerships, which is key to leverage on volume effects, but as well to share knowledge and risk with partners. So to conclude, here are four takeaways. Which were basically discussed during this presentation. So the first one is that policymakers are pushing the auto market toward a lower emissions level. So fuel economy regulations, quota systems, and system policies are all playing a growing role in the development of both electric vehicles and charging networks. So next point is related to technical innovations, which is expected on the short to medium term. So this is, for instance, strong improvements expected at the battery levels with better energy density raising year after year, but as well for increasing charging stations time, well, reducing charging stations time. To be able to reach this, so modular design will be key to provide a wide range of products, but as well to be able to optimize return on investments. And to finish, so automotive anchor players will have to adapt to these new ecosystems, these new players, such as technological giants, new mobility pure players, but as well adapt their supply chain to this new ecosystem with, for instance, the rise of Asian players. So this was it, and let's switch to the Q&A session now. So we have one question, which is, do we have enough distributed power to charge all these upcoming EV cars? So actually, this is a good question, and this is depending on where these stations are installed, in which region of the world. Actually, as of today, it seems that this is not the main limiting factor, but as we see and as we saw, that charging time will be drastically reduced. This will require increasing power for unit charging stations, and thus this power distribution will become more of a challenge. One way as well will be, or might be, one solution might be to have renewable energy sources, which would be located close to this high number of charging station points. A next question, which is, what are the players and the initiative to develop fast chargers? So we have seen on the slide related to the ecosystem a few names, which is illustrating who are these key players. Some of these players, actually, but it is true that as it is a new and emerging market, what we see is that increasingly we have new players, new entrants, which might be dedicated to some regional markets. So, for instance, some players which are mainly active in the US market or mainly active in the Chinese markets, for instance. And this is supported by both some government fundings, which are pushing for the development of EV and thus investing in charging stations network, and as well by OEMs in some of their local countries. Next question is about what is the differentiated approach, if we have any, in infrastructures for domestic vehicles versus fleets, so meaning taxi, trucks and buses. So the main difference, as we see as of today, is that for fleets, so including taxi, trucks and buses, these will be and are mainly operated by private players, which implies that they have to, if they want to further develop on dedicated cities, for instance, these private players will have to invest in their or partly invest in their own charging stations network to be able to launch their fleet in this dedicated zone. While for private vehicles, so it can be either charged at home or at office, at the office or in the city center. So this will be more relying on public network. Yeah, a question. So related to what are the drivers behind the conservative and the optimistic scenarios? So if you remind, these are the two scenarios of expected growth for the charging stations networks. So actually, for the conservative scenario, we follow we took assumptions or key assumptions behind this scenario is that growth would be mainly limited to what governments and stated policies are saying and stated as of today. So meaning still growth, but a quite moderated growth due to follow in order to be able to follow these new policies and regulations. And the other scenario, so the optimistic scenario, would be actually driven by increasing requests from the consumers to switch towards these EV vehicles. And this would be, for instance, what we have been observing in 2020. So at the end of 2019, we were not expecting such growth in EVs for 2020. And this is actually, this has been mainly driven by a trend of toward a more sustainable transportation way. And so increasingly, consumers wanting to invest in this new type of vehicles. Then a question about how do we see the arrival of actors from commercial electronics in the market? So this would be, for instance, some new players such as Apple. So this is what was presented on one of the first slide related to the key changes in the automotive value chain. So yes, we are seeing a number of tech giants, which are increasingly being more and more interested into this market, as this is associated to promising growth, but as well, this is related to the developments and the developments which will be made at the electronics levels. And so this is where this is one of the major changes actually compared to traditional automotive cars. Traditional cars, this is actually the fact that we will have increasingly more and more electronics and high power and more efficient electronics in the cars, which enable new players which already develop some strong skills in this field to enter into this new market. We have one more question. So related to the modular design, so question is why are we expecting to have a modular design and what is the target in terms of cost and assembly? So modular design, actually, there is two main reasons for suppliers to leverage on modular design. So first one will be to be able to answer to a quite strongly, quite highly evolving demands for at the system level. So for instance, if we take the charging stations, so we see that as of today, we are able to provide charging stations which can charge your car in between 30 to 45 minutes, which can be one of the standards as of today. If we want to be able to quickly decrease this time, this will require higher power at the unit charging station level. And so by stacking, for instance, some power modules, it will enable a supplier to answer to this new demand in quite a short time to market, while on top of this, leveraging as well on the investments which will be required to develop this new components. And so optimize their return on investments on this. Okay, so I see we are just on time. So it's now the end of this webinar. So thanks a lot to all of you for your participations, as well for the questions which has been raised. If there are any questions which we would not have been answering at the end, please feel free to reach us, and we would be happy to continue the discussions together with you after this webinar. So thanks a lot, and as discussed, you will receive, as mentioned, you will receive the next Monday, so the replay of the webinar, and on top of this, the slides which has been presented. Thanks a lot to everyone, and have a good day. Bye bye.